Boating has long been part of Irish life. For generations, it has brought the joy of the great outdoors to thousands of children. But in recent times, Scouting's image has been tarnished by child sex abuse allegations and a failure over many years to implement a robust child protection policy. Tonight, we examine how Scouting Ireland's predecessor organisations handle child sex abuse allegations, how sexual predators were free to move between various scout troops.
I hoped I was alone, so I found out later that there was about 60, and that nearly killed me.
How Scouting failed to alert the statutory authorities about suspected predators.
And these people would just drop off the radar. And rarely would you see ever a conviction.
My anger is now at the organisation itself and those people who knew something and didn't do anything.
What was happening should have been reported to Garda.
And how one alleged sexual predator who abused scouts for decades was only removed from the organisation last year.
Well, we sometimes seem to forget, in respect of historic allegations of abuse, that the perpetrators may still have access to children.
Tonight, Orty investigates evidence of cover-ups in the Scouting Association of Ireland and the Catholic Boy Scouts of Ireland. How Scouting's delay in reviewing its own files of child sex abuse is affecting abuse survivors. Scouting Ireland, the modern organisation, was founded when the two scouting traditions, the Scouting Association of Ireland and the Catholic Boy Scouts of Ireland, joined together in 2003. It has a devoted membership of roughly 50,000 people countrywide, with much to offer.
There's no doubt that the essence of the organisation is second to none. You know, as a kid, it's the greatest adventure you could ever have. There's nothing like getting out in the wild, out in the open, and putting up a tent, getting timber, lighting a fire.
Scouting provides children with resilience. It's a real opportunity for children to develop skills that will be lifelong.
But last December, Scouting Ireland wrote to the Minister for Children, Catherine Zappone, stating that its ongoing review of historic complaints found evidence of extensive, prolonged and organised child sex abuse and abuse at all levels in both scouting organisations. Up to March this year, there were 401 sexual abuse complaints and 247 alleged abusers identified on file in Scouting Ireland. In a recent update, Scouting Ireland says it received 161 cases of abuse reported via its helpline since January last year. Lawyers for the survivors say these figures are not the full picture.
The nature of and size of the abuse is not fully understood at this point in time. My own belief is that the more the matter is investigated, the greater and wider the scale of abuse will become known.
Scouting Ireland's ongoing review of complaints, mainly from the 1960s to the 1990s, found some perpetrators moved from one local group to another, and in one case, moved between two different scouting organisations. One such sexual predator was former scout leader David O'Brien. Our research found that in the 1970s and 80s, he moved between the Scouting Association of Ireland and the Catholic Boy Scouts of Ireland. He was involved with at least five scout troops. By doing this, he managed to evade justice while continuing to have access to children for decades. Paul O'Toole from Artane in Dublin was one of many young scouts sexually assaulted by David O'Brien. He joined the Scouts in the early 70s.
The Scouts were everything. The Scouts was your family outside your own family. They were your friends, that's what everybody was doing. We were all, that was the only thing I had, Scouts. And I loved it.
Like many children in his neighbourhood in Artane, he went to a local scout troop, the 51st Kilmore, where David O'Brien was a scout leader.
He was charming. He was kind of quirky. He took all the kids like the Pied Piper on a bus and everybody trusted him.
But it was on these trips that O'Brien sexually abused children. On a camping trip to Wicklow, O'Brien separated Paul O'Toole from the rest of the boys.
was taken away under the auspice of looking for another campsite. And in the middle of nowhere, there was this hut, and off he'd go abusing. And you could scream all you want because there's a mile of pine trees in every direction.
Paul was sexually assaulted by O'Brien on numerous trips. O'Brien warned Paul not to tell anyone, but he remembers how, amongst themselves, scouts talked about O'Brien's abuse.
There was whispers when I was a kid about Dave O'Brien. Like, everybody seemed to, it seemed to be known an unspoken truth.
Not long after abusing Paul in the mid-70s, O'Brien left the Scouting Association of Ireland's Kilmore Troop to set up a new troop in the same organisation, the 49th Ard Lee. It has now emerged that he continued abusing children there for another 5 years.
So when I was a kid, there were prefab huts here. That's what I remember, is going in there for our scout meetings.
Dave Smith was age 10 when he joined the 49th Ard Lee Scout Troop, where David O'Brien was a leader. He was a quiet, bookish child. Scouting fueled his imagination.
It was one of the few opportunities we had to get out of our area with a group, to be out in the woods and the wild, and that was paradise. The fairies in the woods, the Irish mythology, folklore, that I ate that up as a child.
But on this first night away from home on camp, his joy and innocence came to an end when he was sexually abused by O'Brien.
I woke up feeling a huge weight on my chest and then realised he was on top of me. And he'd put his hand into my sleeping bag, had zipped it down, pulled down my pants and was playing with my genitals. I panicked then and froze and tried to move, and he held me down with his right hand over my mouth and held me down and then digitally penetrated me. His dirty nicotine-stained fingers. I can still smell his hand on my mouth.
Dave Smith was traumatised by the abuse.
I started drinking alcohol when I was 11. I got a job straight out of school, but I would just drink all the money I had and was miserable and suicidal and depressed all the time, and felt that I had to escape from here.
After a very troubled adolescence, Dave Smith emigrated to the US, where he has lived ever since. Our research revealed there was a second sex offender operating in the 49th Ard Lee when O'Brien was there, Jim Leddy, who was an assistant patrol leader in the troop.
What James Leddy did abused me when I was a kid.
Both men targeted Colin Bracken.
When I joined the Scouts when I was 11, Jim Leddy and Dave O'Brien, they were my four sexual experiences, you know? And that's crazy. They shattered my soul. They killed my soul.
Last month, Jim Leddy was jailed for 8 months with five suspended for the indecent assault of Colm. During his trial, Jim Leddy stated that the type of abuse he perpetrated went on in the Scouts at the time and was somewhat normalised. Even though Scouts spoke to each other about the abuse, survivors like Paul O'Toole regret not formally reporting it.
One of the greatest burdens is that I didn't get to open my mouth 40 years previous. But you do know instinctively, paedophiles don't just take one victim and stop.
After a parent from the 49th Ard Lee Troop complained to the leadership of the Scouting Association of Ireland, David O'Brien was removed but was not reported to Gardaí. O'Brien was then able to join a Catholic Boy Scouts troop in Westland Row, where he continued abusing boys.
That could only happen through negligence or just incompetence, you know, or the fact that in our culture, that this is something so horrible that nobody wants to even talk about it. I'm not suggesting that everybody in the Scouts was complicit, but certainly the people who knew didn't do anything.
Much later in 1997, one of O'Brien's survivors formally reported him, but no prosecution followed. 15 years later, in 2012, a wider Garda inquiry began after O'Brien admitted details of his abuse to a counsellor. In 2015, he was convicted of the indecent assault of Paul, Dave, Colm, and three others, for which he received a 4.5-year prison sentence. Last month, he was convicted of the sexual assault of a further four people and received a 6.5-year sentence. However, O'Brien admitted abusing many more.
As I found out later that there was about 60, and that nearly... nearly killed me to think. And even in court, I was looking down at Colm and Dave. I even said to them, if I had opened my mouth, maybe he wouldn't have got to use. That's a burden you carry, and I will carry it. It doesn't go away, that one.
Many survivors like Paul feel a burden of guilt for not speaking out. But experts say it was up to adult members to report suspected crimes to the Gardaí.
There were no statutory frameworks or guidelines as we understand them now, particularly in relation to different types of child abuse. However, it was always the case that a crime or an action or an incident that was likely to result in a criminal prosecution should be reported to the guards.
In response to questions we put to Scouting Ireland about how complaints about David O'Brien and alleged abusers were handled in the former scouting organisations, it said, "Many of your questions relate to historic cases of sexual abuse in the Catholic Boy Scouts and the Scouting Association of Ireland. We cannot comment on these individual cases." The statement goes on to say that Scouting Ireland deeply regrets the hurt caused to children through the unlawful and unacceptable actions of adults in these organisations. Despite an obligation to report knowledge or allegations of abuse to Gardaí, there's evidence that many perpetrators in the Catholic Boy Scouts of Ireland, or CBSI, either went unreported or undetected for many decades up to the 1990s. The CBSI was always closely connected with the Catholic Church, and our research indicates that the church authorities became involved in some complaints that were brought to the CBSI because the alleged perpetrators were also priests, Christian brothers, or were otherwise connected to the church. For example, when Father Sean Fortune's abuse of scouts was reported to a bishop in the late 1970s, he was moved to a Belfast parish where he set up his own independent scout troop and continued abusing children. In other cases, it was the perpetrator's status within the community and the scouts that made it difficult for victims to complain. Dennis O'Shea from Middleton in Cork was a scout leader and teacher in the local Christian Brothers school. It's estimated that he abused over 200 children from the 1970s to the 1990s. One of his survivors believes it was O'Shea's status in the Christian Brothers and as the CBSI Diocesan Commissioner and Director of the Mount Mellery Scouting Centre that protected him.
He was the head guy, you know. He was the main man. There was no one questioned anything he did. Oh, he's totally untouchable.
Dennis O'Shea's survivor says that he can't understand why it took until 2000 for him to be convicted.
Everyone in the town spoke about it, all the kids spoke about it, you know, so it's impossible that they didn't know about it. How can someone treat so many kids and have so much accessibility and to use their headquarters in Mount Mellery and bring kids down there and get away with it?
What was happening should have been reported to Gardaí. You had the individual responsibility to report a crime. You also had what was a moral and a public service obligation to report, particularly in relation to vulnerable children, a crime to the Gardaí.
We asked many former senior members of the Catholic Boy Scouts to speak to us about this on camera. They declined, with the exception of Frank Butler, who was a senior member of the CBSI National Training Team from the early to the late 1980s.
I was a member of the National Training Team, and meeting leaders on the coalface, this is how you got information. People would confide in you, and they would sort of say, "Did you hear about Joe Soap? He's been caught." And these people would just drop off the radar. Now, I can't recall anyone I know being convicted. They were just gone.
More recently, Frank learned what was secretly going on.
all of this protection of people who were involved in alleged abusers, how they were looked after. That was all hidden from us.
Scouting Ireland's briefing on its ongoing review of abuse cases identifies a culture of secrecy and significant failings at leadership level in both the former CBSI and SAI organisations. The review states there was evidence of cover-up, suspicions that in the mid-1990s, files relating to child abuse went missing in both organisations, with indications that one senior member allegedly colluded with a known abuser of children, another senior member, and facilitated that abuse. The ongoing review describes how the Scouts now have multiple allegations against this adult member, who held office from the 1970s to the 1990s. Orty Investigates understands that one senior office holder referred to in Scouting Ireland's briefing document is the former National Commissioner and Chief Scout, Joseph Lawler. Mr. Lawler, who died in 2009, is alleged to have engaged in inappropriate behaviour of a sexual nature with children.
In Monaghan town, an impressive parade of over 1,000 Catholic Boy Scouts of Ireland and Girl Guides took place at the National Commissioner of the Scouting Movement, Mr. Joe Lawler, was among those present in Monaghan for the Golden Jubilee of its establishment in the Clogher Diocese.
From the 1970s to the late 1990s, Mr. Lawler was one of the Catholic Boy Scouts' most powerful leaders. As the organisation grew over those decades, Joseph Lawler became a national figure. However, our research reveals that during this time, there were allegations about Joseph Lawler. The national trainer, Frank Butler, recalls meeting a survivor of Joseph Lawler in the 1980s.
I was running a training course, and this young man, who was being quite non-participative, shall I say, and he said, "I want to confide something in you, you know," that the then Chief Scout had abused him when he was a cub.
At the time, this former cub did not want Frank Butler to formally complain. We traced four survivors of Joseph Lawler, including this man who gave us a statement. He described how on camp, Joseph Lawler would check the scouts were not wearing underpants under their pyjamas at night. I was inspected by Mr. Joe Lawler, using a torch and looking into the sleeping bag, and he occasionally put his hand into some people's sleeping bags, and how people would usually point out their underwear on top of their sleeping bags so as to avoid an inspection. This did not always work. A second former scout said that when he received first aid from Joseph Lawler in the late 1960s, my pulse temperature was taken by placing his hand down inside the front of my trousers. A third survivor also gave us a statement that he was molested by Joseph Lawler in 1970. He was 11 years old and had attended Mr. Lawler for first aid with a foot injury.
One of the times I ran for Chief Scout, I approached him and I said, "Joe, you really shouldn't be doing this job, running for Chief Scout." And he said, "Why?" And I said, "I think you know, Joe, why. You know," I said, "I think it's generally known about your activities." And he said, "If you say anything about that, I'll take the full weight of the law. With full weight of the law, be brought down on you." He wrote me a letter not too long after that, accusing me of being anti-Catholic, non-Catholic.
Our research also reveals that as early as the late 1960s, in the Coolach Artane troop where Joseph Lawler was a scout leader, other leaders spoke about his sexually inappropriate behaviour. Paul Connor, a former scout leader from the troop, remembers being told when at a meeting preparing for a camp.
After they discussed previous camps, they said a bit of advice: if you need first aid on camp, don't go to Joe Lawler. So when I asked why was that, they said that whatever ailment you went to first aid for, to Joe, even with a headache, it was, you know, "I'll just check to make sure you haven't been ruptured and stick the hand down the trousers or up the trousers." That was or try to take the shorts off.
As part of the CBSI leadership, Joseph Lawler was in a position to influence the way in which complaints, including allegations of abuse, were handled. Both Joseph Lawler and a second national leader occupied positions which, according to Scouting Ireland's briefing document, may have allowed them to intervene directly in those cases through their access to confidential files and related documentation. This programme uncovered internal documents which do not name the second national leader, but indicate that he acted inappropriately when involved in a child protection case as late as 2012. Scouting Ireland's briefing to the minister also states it has found evidence that adult members who preyed on children were protected. Our research indicates an example of this in the case of one Belfast Scout leader, Martin Kerr, who was not removed from the Scouts despite complaints about his physical abuse of children. In the late 1980s, St. Peter's Scout Troop in Belfast off the Falls Road was at the heart of the parish where many young boys went to the Scouts. One of its Scout leaders was parish sacristan Martin Kerr. Another Scout leader at St. Peter's was Sean Curley. He remembers the day in the late 1980s when on a Scout trip, he witnessed a Scout being horsewhipped and assaulted by Martin Kerr.
So we went to a horse riding event, and I heard this merciful whack, ah, whack, ah, whack, ah, and he asked me, freak me, what's going on? So it was, I was getting there to the bus to see what was going on, and one of the kids got into the bus and he says, please take me home, please take me home, where Martin had him with the horse whip, whatever it was. So I says, that's okay, so I'll take you home. And I was saying to myself, this can't go on. Martin Kerr physically grabbed that child by the scruff of the neck and pulled him out of the Scout bus that I was in and put him into his car. Don't know where he went, brought him home, I don't know where he went with him.
After this incident, and having previously seen Kerr kicking a child, Sean was determined to have Kerr removed. He went to both the diocesan Scout leadership and to the Catholic Boy Scouts headquarters in Herbert Place, Dublin.
They took me to Dublin. I went to Herbert Place and had a meeting. Told all of us there. I told them about Martin physically abusing the kids.
While the CBSI shut down the Scout troop, citing an internal dispute between Curley and Kerr, Kerr was reassigned to a significant regional role where he continued to have access to children.
Martin Kerr was so powerful in the Scouts, nothing was going to touch him. So when they closed in St. Peter's Scouts, so they promoted him. Instead of saying to him, Martin, look, you have to leave because he's, no, they promoted him.
Kerr also continued to have access to children in a youth club he set up. 7 years after Sean Curley lodged complaints about Kerr's physical abuse, he was reported to police by parents for sexual abuse. In 1998, Kerr received a 2-year jail sentence and in 2005, a further 1 year for over 50 counts of indecent assault of children within the Scouts and in St. Peter's Parish. Sean Curley believes that had the Catholic Boy Scouts adequately addressed Kerr's behaviour at the time he complained, it could have prevented his further abuse of children.
This is very, very sad, deeply, deeply pertinent to me because it was happening under my control as the unit leader, you know. Sad.
Coming up in part two, why it has taken so long for the truth about the Scouts to come out.
They sat on the files for years. How many other children have suffered because of their silence?
In part one, we saw how Scouting's forerunner organisations, the Catholic Boy Scouts of Ireland and the Scouting Association of Ireland, appeared to have covered up abuse and failed to act on complaints. These organisations were succeeded by Scouting Ireland, a part publicly funded organisation formed in 2003 in the aftermath of some of Ireland's worst child abuse scandals. As a youth organisation, Scouting Ireland was obliged to conform with a range of child protection measures introduced as a result of these abuse revelations, including the 1999 Children First Guidelines. In 2004, when the newly formed Scouting Ireland inherited hundreds of files of historic abuse complaints made over the decades, these files were left unopened by Scouting Ireland. and these files remained stored away throughout the 2000s, even when revelations of child sex abuse were to the fore in Irish society.
One would have thought that the prudent approach in the establishment of the new organisation, Scouting Ireland, would have been to undertake a comprehensive risk assessment.
But this did not happen. Then in late 2011, the organisation discovered that a leader who'd been previously removed because of serious allegations against him was back in their ranks.
Almost accidentally, we came upon an issue where an individual had been removed from one of the, if you'll forgive me calling it, legacy organisations in 1972, had been found in late 2011 to be active in scouting. When that was discovered, he was immediately removed.
This prompted Scouting Ireland to review its historic files. Of 332 files, it referred five to the Gardaí. The review determined that in the remaining files, all necessary reporting had taken place.
It's my view that they should have referred really the entire tranche of files that they had to the relevant statutory authorities. And the statutory authorities then would have said, that's fine, you should hand them over to us.
Ortie Investigates has seen minutes from Scouting Ireland's 2012 board meetings. They show that the organisation had planned at that time to do a comprehensive investigation of historic complaints. This was due to include all files held by Scouting Ireland, including those held in the Scouts archive in Mount Mellory. Yet, once again, a full review did not happen at that time. Then in 2017, Scouting Ireland employed child protection expert Ian Elliott as their safeguarding manager. He began a historical review of files and also reviewed all current safeguarding procedures and complaints. He confirmed there were close to 1,000 complaints files, almost half of which were abuse cases. Since setting up a helpline 1 year ago, Scouting Ireland has referred 173 complaints to TUSLA and 176 to the Gardaí and PSNI, cases which are now finally under investigation. Scouting Ireland acknowledges a delay in reviewing its files.
How many files are we looking at that is locked away in the secret dungeon?
Just to say that I do agree with you that we have been slow in doing it. We should have done this sooner.
In relation to its first 2012 internal review, the CEO admitted its problems.
Now, I will say it had the limitation that it was staff-led by ourselves, and it would be nobody with the expertise and insight of somebody like Ian Elliott. So we did do that, and that was our due diligence at the time.
Any opportunity missed to deal with an allegation of abuse is deeply regrettable, because that opportunity can leave a perpetrator having access to future victims.
We asked Scouting Ireland why it took until 2017 to begin a comprehensive process of reviewing its historic files of complaints. They declined to answer this, but stated, since its inception in 2003, Scouting Ireland has always reported all information on alleged sexual offences, which has been brought to our safeguarding team's attention to the appropriate authorities. An abuse survivor from North Dublin says that when Scouting Ireland became aware of its abuse problem, it should have been more proactive in encouraging others to come forward.
We sat on the files for years. Then people should be made the answer for their actions. How many other children have suffered because of their silence?
This man, who's diagnosed as severely post-traumatic, says it was only when Scouting Ireland went public in 2018 and encouraged people to come forward via helpline that he had the courage to report his abuser.
Well, now all I suppose I want to see is justice for myself and other people who were abused. Hopefully the momentum builds and he gets convicted.
Only now, after 20 years, is his abuser under investigation by Gardaí. And only now has this survivor begun his recovery.
Ever since I made the first report, it was like a weight lifted off my chest, and each milestone I hit, making a statement to the Gardaí, going to counselling, being open to my family, it's just got easier and easier and easier.
Another survivor, this time from Cork, is concerned that a file of complaint to the Catholic Boy Scouts in the 1980s about an alleged perpetrator was not properly addressed. The complaint relates to a former scout leader who molested him and other boys in Kilcully Scout Centre in Cork. He remembers how the CBSI removed the leader from the scouts and how the leader then moved to Dublin.
I mean, the first worry you'd have is he still engaging in that type of behaviour? If the scouts are sincere about what they're trying to achieve, people who did bad things should be held to account. People in authority had knowledge of this behaviour and facilitated that. Well, then that's an even bigger problem, I would suggest.
The former National Executive Board member, Frank Butler, also remembers the complaint being made. He recalls that the Catholic Boy Scouts removed the scout leader, but did not report him to Gardaí. And later, there was an attempt to bring him back into the Scouts.
After a while, there was an effort made to reinstate him back into CBSI.
And how do you know that?
Because I was at the meeting. I did hear that he was used on a team after that meeting. But when it became known that he was on the team, he was asked through the person who brought him back in to remove himself and step aside.
We asked Scouting Ireland if they had uncovered this file and reported it. In a statement, Scouting Ireland say, "We cannot comment on individual cases." The statement went on to say that Scouting Ireland remains committed to implementing and maintaining the strongest possible safeguarding processes. Scouting's delay in investigating historic abuse cases has also left many survivors suffering its effects without acknowledgement for years.
The longer it takes for victims to achieve justice, the more damaging it will be on the victims. Because what victims are looking for is they're looking for justice and a resolution.
Clonmel is a town with a vibrant scouting tradition. It also maintains silence about past abuse. We spoke to 7 survivors who were abused by 2 different scout leaders during their time at the Scouts in the local unit during the 1980s. One survivor, who doesn't want to be identified, so we've called him Connor, is still seeking justice.
I just want my apology. I want them to accept liability. They just don't want to accept that it happened. Like,
Connor was diagnosed with post-traumatic stress and has a personal injury claim against Scouting Ireland. His case remains ongoing 7 years after his abuser, who cannot be named for legal reasons, was given a suspended sentence for crimes against him in 2012. Connor is also angry that the Catholic Boy Scouts failed to properly investigate the full extent of this scout leader's abuse against him and others in the 1980s. He remembers how he was just 9 years old when he was lured into a toilet cubicle on the pretense of playing a game.
He used to give me a 20 pence piece with a horse on it, and called, if the game was called Horsey, and that's, you know, that lived with me forever. Like, I won't forget that. I went in and he done his whatever he had to do, like, you know, and memories are there, they're very graphic in my head, like, so, you know, lives with me every day.
Connor was sexually assaulted in this way over months. He believes another scout leader, Joseph Nugent, was often present when he was being abused.
In the cubicles, like, they'd be actually talking to each other about stuff, like, that stuck with me forever, like, that's day and night, everything. I live with that, like, them voices. I can still hear them right now as I speak to you. I can hear them in my head, like.
Kieran Cleary is a local solicitor representing survivors.
So they were a team operating in the same building at the same time. They were always together.
When another child's mother reported the first scout leader to Gardaí, he was removed from the Scouts. The following year, in 1988, he received a fine after pleading guilty to the indecent assault of 2 other boys. However, the abuse by Joseph Nugent went undetected at the time, and he remained in the Scouts in Clonmel for a further 15 years, where he continued abusing children. Our research also uncovered other unreported victims of both men.
There's 5 people we know of, just offhand. I mean, how many more was there, like?
In 2002, a survivor reported his abuse by Nugent to the Catholic Boy Scouts. As a result, Nugent was removed.
Nobody wanted to speak. That was the problem back then, and no one wanted to get involved.
3 years later, in 2005, when the survivor who'd reported Nugent to the Scouts observed him in a local sports club with children, he immediately went to Gardaí. A former CBSI member told RT Investigates he understood the matter had been reported to the Gardaí at the time of the complaint. However, in 2008, on Nugent's conviction, the court was told that the first time Nugent was reported to Gardaí was in 2005, 3 years after he was reported to the CBSI. He was convicted on 9 counts of indecent assault.
What would you like to see happen?
A lot of investigations, really. A lot of books opened, a lot of people interviewed. Most victims have done it. They've spoke their part. We've done our bit, like. I mean, now it's up to the people that were in charge to come out and speak. Why don't the good ones come up and speak? Why is it all kind of brushed under the carpet?
Coming up in part 3, we find an alleged abuser about whom complaints were made to the Catholic Boy Scouts over decades was only removed from the Scouts last year.
The fact that he was there up until 12 months ago, it's hard to stomach it, really.
In 2017, when Scouting Ireland finally began its review of past abuse, it found that the organisation's child protection policies, even at that time, were not meeting required standards. The child protection expert Ian Elliott found a lack of awareness of risk within Scouting Ireland and described the handling of a rape allegation in 2016 as deeply flawed. As a result, the Children's Minister, Catherine Zappone, suspended the organisation's funding and ordered a full governance review by expert Gillian von Turnout, who's also a former Chief Commissioner of the Irish Girl Guides.
I found a distrust between staff and volunteers at certain levels. What permeated throughout my review was the issue of culture and the dysfunctional culture that existed within Scouting Ireland. It really was about who you are and who you know within the system would determine on how a case would be dealt with.
Following these damning reports, Scouting Ireland's child protection policy was overhauled, but controversy erupted again this year about its implementation.
In recent days, TUSLA, the Child and Family Agency, has written to Scouting Ireland, highlighting serious concerns about that organization. Scouting Ireland should consider the viability of continuing with overnight trips.
Scouting Ireland is a safe organization.
Certainly, Scouting Ireland has provided best practice up to now. I know it might be hard to credit that given the recent controversies.
Scouting Ireland says it aims to be fully compliant with required governance codes by the end of 2020. In its ongoing briefings on child protection, Scouting Ireland says it refers cases every year to TUSLA and the Gardaí. In relation to historic complaints to its helpline, it says they relate only to the SAI and CBSI and not the current organisation.
At the time of this committee meeting, the most recent case that has come to Scouting Ireland's attention has been 1998. The majority of cases still refer to the decades between 1960s and 1990s.
However, we identified one long-standing Scout leader, now under guard investigation for abuse, who was present in the organisation until late last year and even attended the 2018 Jamboree. His alleged abuse spans decades from the 1980s to the 2000s. We also found a number of complaints were made about him to the CBSI over the decades, with one complaint as early as 1987. We spoke to one survivor who was molested by this former Scout leader over a 5-year period in the late 80s and early 90s. From the age of 8, he was frequently brought back to the Scout leader's home overnight with groups of scouts. The worst abuse happened in his bed.
It was always in the middle of the night. Child's nightmare was always in the middle of the night. Then you'd hear the door opening.
A second survivor who lives abroad spoke to us by phone. He told us what he endured and witnessed in the same leader's home.
Inappropriate touching, fondling, showering with kids. He was fully naked going into the shower. Fully naked going into the shower with pre-teenage kids. That was something that he did on a regular basis.
This programme has established that a complaint was made to the local troop about a separate incident of inappropriate behaviour which took place in the same Scout leader's home in 1987. In response, the local scout unit council said that the leader had been severely reprimanded for holding and funding a function in his home, which was not an official scouting one. He was directed to stop making payments out of his own pocket for various items and functions. Yet, a number of survivors told us they were abused in the scout leader's home in the months and years after this. They were regularly brought to his house, particularly over the summer.
You would have been back to his house at least twice a month or even more, three or four times a month while you were training for the competition.
Other leaders were sometimes present at the unofficial scouting events held in the scout leader's home.
There were definitely times when there were other scout leaders there. There was nearly kind of semi-official functions held there as well.
This probe can reveal that the parent who complained in 1987 complained a second time in 1996. On this occasion, the parent went directly to the National Office of the Catholic Boy Scouts of Ireland, expressing concern that no action had been taken to stop the scout leader bringing scouts to his home. Orty Investigates understands that even after this second complaint, the scout leader continued to take scouts back to his house.
A memo from a meeting held with the CBSI officer records that the parent requested a copy of their submission be provided to all appropriate officers of the CBSI who would consider the complaint. The memo also states that the parent's requests were communicated to officers of the CBSI, who it says will respond in due course. And yet it appears no action was taken and abuse by the scout leader continued.
In the 90s, if the case came to light, we could have still done something about it. It mightn't have helped me, but it might have helped somebody else. The fact that he was there up until 12 months ago, you know, it's hard to stomach it, really.
I am extremely pissed off about it, what was going on, both from, you know, an emotional and physical aspect that you understand that, hey, this is really wrong.
A Garda investigation into the scout leader remains ongoing. Survivors are angry that Scouting Ireland took so long to take action.
People are still, you know, falling through the cracks and getting away with this. This should never happen. I mean, me being a father, I would never want this to happen to any of my kids. So I'm really angry about it. From my perspective, I think there should be a public inquiry.
Scouting Ireland declined to comment on questions we put to them about this case. Other survivors of abuse want more questions answered about the past too.
There can't be any moving forward till there's accountability for what they let happen.
For many of the survivors we've spoken to, their lives were forever changed from the moment they were sexually assaulted.
That was the moment, I believe, that my childhood ended. I'd gone into a state where I couldn't be conscious and sober at the same time. I had to be out of my head. And between alcohol and drugs and any other kind of abuse I could give to myself, just to try and stay unconscious. Oblivion was the best place to be.
I can't go back and relive my childhood. It was stolen from me. My childhood was never the same again after that. And then my adult life was never the same. You know, self-medication, self-abuse, self-destructive behavior, not being able to have proper relationships with people, doubting yourself all the time, all of these things that become ingrained in your psyche.
You blame yourself. And then you say to yourself, why are you blaming yourself? It's not your fault you didn't do anything. It's his fault. You look for reasons why it's you. Where were you picked?
And for some survivors like Colm, the self-destructive thoughts led to serious psychiatric illness.
One day I turned around and I packed the bag, I put a rope in it, Stanley blades, and I said, that's it, no more, can't do it anymore. And that's it, I'll do away myself. And ironically, my phone rang, and it was my 10-year-old son. And he saved my life.
Reports of a cover-up in the Scouts is now a topic worldwide. In the US, the lawyer who discovered hundreds of thousands of secret files within the Boy Scouts of America, known as the Perversion Files, with names of alleged perpetrators not reported, sees similarities with what happened here.
Well, there's an exact parallel. In the United States, for over a century, the Boy Scouts of America quietly removed abusers and never reported them to the police. The same thing went on in Ireland. And I'm getting emails from people who are involved in scouting as far away as India, Australia, New Zealand, South Africa. So I believe this to be a worldwide phenomenon. You cannot trust the organization that created the problem to police itself. And I think we've all learned from the experience with the Catholic Church and other institutions that you don't put the fox in charge of guarding the hen house.
Scouting Ireland says that their historic review is not a case of the organization investigating itself. But a legal expert says that our past failures in scouting warrant an independent inquiry.
It should be independent. So it shouldn't involve members of the organisation under review. It should be prompt, particularly in the context of children, because other children may be at risk. And it should be transparent. In other words, the results of that review should be made publicly available.
2 years later, and the review being carried out by Scouting Ireland is ongoing, with a planned date of completion of February 2020. Uncovering the whole truth about scouting's dark past is important for survivors.
That's the whole reason. Well, I've waited, Paul and Dave have, because we want more people to come forward.
They're not doing enough. It's like when it's out of the media spotlight, it just goes quiet. Everything's just silent. Why aren't they telling people who came forward, telling us what's going on and what stage that they're at?
Getting to the truth is also important for those who want a positive future for scouting.
It's a great organisation. I made lifelong friends. I learned a lot of life skills in it. So my motivation is, let's clean it up. Let's tell it as it was.
I believe in scouting, and I think what scouting does on the ground is amazing. It is absolutely phenomenal, and what volunteers do. We need to get back to what scouting is good about, what its purpose is.